This is Songs on Fire, the show where I trade songs and stories with some of my favorite artists and good friends right from my backyard. My name is Ben Kunder, and I'm a singer-songwriter. I love to talk to other singer-songwriters about why they do what they do. Today's special guest is Julian Taylor.
One, two, three, four. In a six string, I'd made this deal. I was barely 17, armed with delusions of a dream. Each tried for days all along the northwest, with no knowledge in my chest of ways and means and schemes. By the time I reached Seattle, I arrived by train. It was called the Empire Builder. I don't know how it got his name. Barely old enough to drink, but I always found a way. Often stumbling out into the streets with the moon shining on my back, singing la da 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 da. Few more years, I would try again. This time with my friends who shared much of the same sense of wonder or desire for fame. As the white lines hurtle past the asphalt, how quickly that would change. We headed out on the 401, feeling no pain, until one day all of that turned to shame. So much was in us at the time that helped me to close my mind and try not to think at all as we braced for the fall, singing la da 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 da. Da 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 da
promised in this life is taken away so easily. And that reality wasn't crafted to be what it was meant to be. When in doubt, I look back to when I was 17. And all the miles and miles and miles that I've seen. Each inch of pavement has a story to tell. Some I can't recall, others I remember all too well. Singing la da 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 da. La da 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 da. Takes no chances unless with you.
Julian, my friend.
Yes, how are you?
Welcome, I'm very well. How are you?
I'm very well as well.
Good, yeah. Very well as well.
Yeah.
So, you've been writing songs and making music for over 2 decades.
Yes.
And you've put out a record recently under your own solo name.
Like my own
your
name?
Your own solo record. I mean,
name that my mama gave me?
That's one. It, right?
Yeah.
And it's an incredible record.
Thank you.
And it's been getting a lot of deserved recognition. So how are you feeling?
I feel multitudes, really. Like, I feel many, many things. After being in this for over 2 decades and looking back at all of it, you know, it's a funny thing. I count how many songs I've actually published and like that are out there in the public ether space.
Sure.
And it's 125 songs. And I'm like, that's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
The fact that the last record I released, The Ridge, was received the way it was received was a
and
bit
still.
Of, and still, I mean, it's kind of wild. I mean, I have a feeling like that record may continue to do that, because I think it's a record that really struck a chord with people. And for no apparent reason, it wasn't for me trying to strike a chord.
Mm-hmm.
It's just me, it was me doing what I've always done and just try to write the best song and record it. And for the first time, what I ended up doing this time was like, I just sort of stopped caring about what I was recording. And I mean, I lowered my register a little bit so I could tell some stories properly, as if I was speaking to people. And I just took all of that sort of egocentric, sort of narcissistic approach to my own being out of the equation. And I'm doing that now as well. I just, basically the way I look at it is like, I don't have any competition. I don't, there's nobody
sure.
that I feel like is better or worse than me. I just don't care. Like, you're an amazing artist.
Yeah.
I'm an amazing artist and we're friends, and that's amazing.
Yeah, it's community, right?
And like the rest of it, you know, I'm really happy that people felt this record, and I hope they feel the next, but I have no control over it. I have every control over creating it and putting it out, and I think that's a victory in itself. Because, I mean, I can hardly even do my laundry.
It is, yeah, I mean, it is incredible. You spend so much time. I mean, I wonder, because you say you don't give a fuck.
It's like,
I don't mean
it's not like I don't give a fuck. That's the wrong thing to say. What I'm trying to tell you is that I care so much that I have the ability now to remove myself from the end result.
Yeah, sorry, I shouldn't have said that you don't give a fuck. You've let go. You've let go of the ego and of the parts of the creation and the process that might sort of cloud you, your mind from actually creating an honest piece of an honest song.
Sure, I don't, if anybody likes it, awesome. If they don't, awesome. It's about the work.
Yeah.
It's about putting in the time. It's about, like I said, okay, when it comes to like, you know, I don't have any competition. I don't have to impress anyone. The only person that I have to do that to is sitting in this body.
Yeah.
Which isn't even really, like, it's mine, but it's not really mine anyways either. So I'm like, all right, well, I'll do the best with what I've got.
Yeah.
And then one day I you know, anyways, it's like, I'm basically a spiritual being living in this body, and whatever I put out there is part of the spiritual element, and the other stuff isn't really as important as that to me anymore. When in the beginning of my career, it was all about exterior things. It's all about internal feelings now.
Yeah. Is that associated with, at some point, realizing that you're creating a body of work? It's not just about sort of being in the moment, but you've... So there was a point in my, you know, musical career when I stopped thinking about, you know, reaching an audience or my ego or certain things, and it became about like, no, you write songs, you create these records, you're not in a box, you don't have to be in a box, you are here for the long haul, you're creating a body of work. And once I realized that I wasn't, you know, trying to fit in somewhere, mm-hmm. that I was just sort of moving artistically through my career, like moving from song to song and record to record, and building that body of work, I let go a lot of the anxiety and the tension I felt about like
writing songs. It's interesting that you would say body of work, because the choice of words that you use is something that I look at words in such a way that I really take them seriously sometimes. Mm. And so when you're saying, Ben, that you're creating a body of work, when I hear that and when you say that, I basically break it down to your actual body, like your physical body is creating this particular pieces of work, and how your body changes is interesting because, I mean, metaphysically and spiritually, your body changes with you,
of course,
throughout every period of your life. And so your body of work is your history and your story here and now. You can't really tell the future history, but you can at least try. Does that make any sense?
Yeah.
Like, I write songs where I'm trying to think about what's going on over here while I'm here, remembering what was here. Like, somebody asked me a question about, do I look at it as therapy? And I say, well, no, I don't really look at it as therapy. I know that a lot of art is created from suffering and the conquering of suffering, but I also look at it as at my art and what I'm trying to speak to as being here and remembering there so that I can get there. And when I get there, everybody else will remember me from here. So maybe that's what the body of work is doing. It's like me, like running a race. And I always think that, you know, actually it's not really a race. I wrote a song called Human Race, and then I realized later that it's not really a race, like, to the end, because nobody ever reaches the summit. It's more like a relay race where you pass a baton.
Interesting. So Human Race is about...
Human Race is about a person...
A relay race? No.
I wish it was.
Yeah.
But maybe I'll write one about that, about passing the baton. Because I think that it's such an interesting thing when you're on a track and all of a sudden you're racing and all of a sudden you have people in that same on that same track racing to get to where you wanted to go, and you pass the baton and it's like they go, and then you're like, and then you stop and you watch them in the distance and you see them go, and it's pretty romantic to see that happen. It's for me more romantic than finishing the line and having all the people go yay. There's a story, actually. Oh, this is a cool story.
Share it with me.
I read, like, when I go for walks or runs, I listen to audiobooks, and I can't remember who told the story. I can't remember. Maybe it was Eckhart Tolle, but if it was Eckhart Tolle, he would have told it in, like, slow motion, so it probably wasn't him. But anyways, the story goes where there was this Special Olympics, I guess, right? Mm. And there were all these individuals lined up at the starting gun, right? And everybody's in the stands, and the shotgun goes, like, you're on, it's time to race. Go, win the race. And all of the individuals at the Special Olympics took off, ready to go to the finish line. And they were running. It's a 100-meter dash, basically, you know what I mean?
Sure.
And one of them fell. And the rest of them stopped racing and went back to pick up the other one who fell. Mm-hmm. And they all walked to the finish line together.
Yeah.
And for me, like, I don't really know what I'm talking about, but that's really, really amazing and beautiful. I think what I'm trying to say is that that's how I feel like my art and the art that my friends create feels to me. Like, I don't feel like I'm trying to race to the end anymore. I'm just trying to be part of something, be part of a community, be able to pick other people up, hope that they would do the same for me, and use the words and the melodies as a place and space for people to reside and feel comfortable in.
That's beautiful.
You know?
Yeah, that's. I mean, that's what this is about too. That's what this space is about. It's about building
community. It feels
community.
That
it's
way,
about,
yeah.
Sharing stories, because, I mean, I've recently been doing some workshops on anti-oppression in the music industry, actually. And one of the first things we talked about was power, disseminating power. Mm-hmm. And how do you disseminate power in, this is a general, you know, umbrella thing of power and disseminating power. How do you do that? But specifically in the music industry. And coming from an, you know, an artist standpoint, it feels so common that you, when you get any semblance of sort of recognition or any form of power in that way, where you're being supported or recognized, you hold on to it for dear life because you don't know when it's going to go away. And that's something that, you know, you have to struggle with all the time. It's like you put out a record and you hope that people hear it, and then you can maybe make another record after. And you learn and gather information and knowledge along the way that there's not really anybody to teach you beforehand. Mm-hmm. It's all just sort of trial by error. And you're afraid to, you know, share with community. And I remember when I started out, it was all anybody you knew that was a songwriter, anybody you met, you'd play a show and you'd invite them to like open for you or close the night because you're like, I know you.
Yeah, sure. I
mean, I'll bring out five friends and you bring out five friends.
And now everybody's holding it too close to their...
Yeah, well, I mean, I have definitely, I've you know, become lost at certain points in my musical life where I've been focusing more on myself than on the music or putting it out or building community. And that's...
You know, I don't think there's anything wrong with focusing on yourself at all. I think that, you know, there's moments in time where you have to, you know, even when it... even if it's not musically, like, there's moments in time where I've personally, like, done things to myself that I probably shouldn't have. And then it's a really hard thing to deal with when you think, well, I know that everything happens for a reason, but maybe there's a reason for it, which is an interesting way to look at it. But sometimes, like, you know, you went on a canoe trip with your family recently for like 2.5 weeks. You got right off the dial. Like, you didn't touch your phone and you actually got to live. Imagine that. I think about that all the time. And then I get into this worries zone where you're right. It's like, oh, I got to work. And, you know, it's funny that our the economy and capitalism and the way that our world has worked has put that fear into us. It certainly doesn't help the way that things are going right now either, but that it's a really fear-based society and economy. So when you say, like, you get a tiny bit of success and you're scared to lose it, I'd be lying to you if I said that, you know, if I put out this next record and it's not received like the Ridge, will I be upset? Yeah, there'll be a part of me that might. And, you know, but I have to also, you know, find clarity in the knowing that I have no control. And also, the only thing that matters is that focus that you've put on yourself. Like that. Sometimes it's okay to be like egocentric if it's building blocks to not success, but to your well-being, really.
Of course. I think it's about remembering that you're allowed to focus on yourself and continue. Otherwise, you're not going to grow. You're not going to create new material. You're not going to explore anything new. I mean, more you gather information, you gather knowledge from the choices you make, from the successes, from the ridge, from the possibility of failure, from whatever. It's just more about you know, sharing knowledge with others and with community.
So, I mean, you have young kids, and early on I figured out, oh my God, she's asleep. I should sleep too. This is good. Because when she's awake, I don't.
I haven't figured that out.
I lost that too. But because now she doesn't sleep, but when she was younger, she would. But yeah, I mean, I don't want people to always think about my career as the ridge, because it isn't. I mean, I have favorite records that aren't. Like, I love Last Summer When We Were Famous by Staggered Crossing. I think it's a really cool record. And it was produced by Jay Bennett, who was in Wilco at the time before he passed away. And we were really good friends. We had some really crazy times together. And I really enjoy that record for all of its insanity.
Well, let's talk about that. Let's talk about Staggered Crossing and how you... Did you write all those songs?
I wrote most of the songs. Yeah, most of them. I mean, I, in all that I've done, I've wrote 90% of all the material that I've put out. Julian Taylor Band, there was a moment there, like Dave Engel, keyboard player, great writer, and he and I collaborated on a lot of stuff. So there was like a 50-50 thing going on with a bunch of songs there. But the bulk of it, again, came from my vision, for sure. But like, Never Gonna Give You Up is like a pure collaboration. I mean, that was the first song that Julian Taylor Band put out.
Okay.
And the only reason we were called Julian Taylor Band was because my dad is a wedding photographer. And at the time, we thought we'd get more gigs if people thought that I was his son. And then that song came out and it got played on the radio and we were the Julian Taylor Band.
There you go.
And then, yeah, cool collaboration. But most of it's me. But Dan Black in Staggered Crossing wrote a couple cool riffs, like Business as Usual on Last Summer When We Were Famous is a heavy riff, and that was really him. After Jay and I had hung out for a long time, that's when I started kind of getting into like the producer mode, like being able to put the whole thing together. That was the first time that I was able to figure out that, because before that I would write like 100 songs. Some, like 80% of them were shit. And like, then we'd record them all and then we'd be like, that one's for the record, that one's for the record, that one's for the record, that one is. And now I don't do that. I write like...
Yeah, so tell me, so let's break that down a little bit. So your memory of how you wrote songs for Staggered Crossing compared to how you write songs now for, say, The Ridge or the new record you're working on.
Yeah.
So when you wrote Staggered Crossing, when you wrote records and songs
for that band,
you're saying you were just able to pour out, like, how were you writing at the time? Was it all pen and paper? Were you
guitar? Mostly it was just guitar and just like raging on riffs.
Yeah.
And like, we were a little louder, so like, it was kind of cool. Like, we had a rehearsal space, and so like, some of those songs are not... Most of the songs I've ever written are written on an acoustic guitar. Those songs, some of them were definitely written on an electric guitar.
Okay.
And just like, this is dope. And you know, like, we actually recorded a song for our 20th anniversary record. And I was so happy to be able to just turn up. Like, I've been in my house for like, 18 months? I was like, wow, there's an amplifier?
Yeah. Let's get loud. Okay.
Yeah. Which I enjoy a lot. Loud music's awesome.
Loud music is awesome.
Yeah.
It is. I don't do it. I wrote most of my songs were all finger picking. I started playing classical guitar.
Yeah.
And nylon string.
You've got the folk aesthetic going big time, but loud is pretty cool.
Yeah. At some point, somebody told me, you should probably try writing an up-tempo. And I was like, really? Yeah, maybe.
You play electric guitar, no?
Yeah. You want to hear a funny story about how I learned how to play electric guitar? I only played nylon string guitar from the age of 9 until I was 18 or 19. Only nylon string. And then I went to theater school and I booked a gig at Canada's Wonderland. As it was right after School of Rock, that movie came out with Jack Black.
Cool movie.
And I booked a show at... Wonderland playing the Jack Black character in School of Rock.
So you had to learn how to play.
And it was basically like a half an hour review show of 16 hard rock, classic rock songs.
We were talking Paranoid by Black Sabbath.
Yep, AC/DC, you're talking Guns N' Roses, And I, they gave me a like $5,000 SG, and I was like, I have to figure this out.
Do you
and
still have the SG?
They didn't give it to me. They had it for the show, but I was given this, and then the whole band were all Humber jazz students, who actually are people that I play with
now,
like Anthony Caron, who's in the Arkells, who's played on my records and plays with me sometimes, and Jeremy Clanens, who plays with like the Rec Laws and a bunch of other bands. And
funny how those Humber jazz students are so good at music.
So good.
They're
and
so great.
And the, who was it? James Payne, maybe, was the guitar player. And I was like, oh, you gotta help me, bro. Like, I don't know what I'm doing. And he taught me a bunch of, because I had to do riff offs.
And like power chords.
And shred. I mean, it was in like the Canada's Wonderland Castle, so it wasn't.
That's awesome.
Is that your best gig ever?
That's how I learned how to play electric.
Sounds like the best gig ever.
Guitar. It was fine. It was fine. I wouldn't say the best gig. But I did learn a few things about electric guitar. And then from then on, I started playing much more. And yeah, I love getting loud. Yeah, I don't really have any songs that call for
my
it.
My next record doesn't have like the oomph of the electric guitar like at all. It's like another, you know, acoustic bass record. But damn it, after this record, I'm going to turn it up.
The Julian Taylor Wedding Band is coming back.
Yeah, we're coming back.
So tell me, so Stagger Crossing, you were writing 100 songs, recording them all, and just deciding, you know, in the after the fact, which ones.
Yeah, sure. Best. I mean, they'd all get recorded.
So what's happening now? What happened with The Ridge? What's the
change
of pace?
Ever since 2014's Tech Noir, which I produced with my friend Saam Hashemi.
Yes, who's produced
a lot of
your stuff. Yeah,
I mean, Saam and I have such an amazing working relationship. We just get each other.
Amazing.
He's an incredible mixer and an incredible engineer, an incredible musician, and one in a lifetime kind of talent. This guy, he's that good.
Wow.
I mean, he's the one of the head engineers at CBCQ. He's one of the best in the country, right? And when we met, it just so happens that the way that we sort of jive is like, I'm over here going like this, and he's like this.
Yeah.
And so it works.
A little yin and yang.
Yeah, a little yin and yang. And from that particular record on, I realized something. It's like, I can write 30 songs.
Yeah.
But everything's got to fit. And Jay Bennett taught me that. Like, there's got to be a... Like, Last Summer When We Were Famous was the first record that... The second record Stagger Crossing did, but the first record that I'm a part of that I realized, and Jay always talked about this thread. You need to, like, have a thread from the top of it to the bottom of it that goes... It can meander, it can go straight down, but it has to connect everything together. And so the way I make records now, like for example, The Ridge, you know, there were songs that aren't on The Ridge. There are songs that are not on Avalanche. There's songs that are not on Desert Star. There's songs that were recorded that are on Tech Noir. And this particular record that I'm working on, I'm not sure what I'm going to call it yet, but I have a few working ideas that are same. They're in the same thread. I'll take those songs and I will work them to death.
That's the new Julian Taylor way of writing.
I will take one song and I will work it to death.
What does that mean?
It means, like, for example, like it'll take me, say it takes me 5 minutes to write the song.
Mm-hmm.
I will keep on going back to the song and changing like the smallest of details, because I think the smallest of details have such a major impact. When it's like, even a word or the way you phrase things, mostly words have the most impact. Like, I'll do something where I realized a long time ago that if I wrote the words first, that I wouldn't be married to a melody.
Sure.
Because when you write a song and you have the melody in your head, you're sort of married to it, and then all of a sudden you got to take the words and the words got to fit the melody. Yeah. You write the words first, the melody. The words dictate where the melody goes. which I find extraordinarily more interesting.
Yeah.
For me personally, sure. Because I don't know where it's going to go. And I find that interesting.
Yeah.
It's like a challenge for myself. It's like, oh, neat.
So when you approach that, when you approach a song, are you sitting down and thinking, I'm going to write now? I'm going to try and write a song. I'm going to take 20 minutes. I'm going to take a half hour. Or is it you're walking down the street and you start singing to yourself and something comes? What's...
For me, it's everything, but the most common thing that will happen to me within writing songs now, and it all depends on what I'm writing for, by the way. If I'm writing for myself and I want to really depict what it is that I'm going through and really, you know, hone in on that feeling, then I have to do it a certain way. If you and I were, like, commissioned to write a song, I'd just come over and we'd do it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And we'd just churn it out. We'd sit down. We'd talk about it. We'd go, where's the storyline? Who's it about? What's the character? You know, what chords do we need here? And we could do that. You and I probably within like 3 hours.
Yeah, yeah. If you try and work within the structure of songwriting, of creating a specific.
But I don't do that.
No,
that's not how I operate for my own stuff. Mm-hmm. I'm way outside of. Now, at least, I used to, but now I don't. I'm way outside of what the conventions are anymore.
Yeah.
What I do usually is, like, in the morning, I have, like, a silent time. It's usually 20 minutes where I just sit there. Whether it's, like, lying in my bed, or if I'm meditating, or even if I'm, like, you know, in the shower or whatever, but as long as my mind is operating,
mm-hmm.
if my eyes are closed and my mind's operating, there's ideas that are running through my head, and I can find points in my life, like constellations in my mind. I try to connect the dots. And when I connect the dots, I write them down immediately. And I keep on doing it, and I keep on doing it, and I keep on doing it, and I keep on doing it. It's just the way that I write melodies and the way that I write, you know, chord structures or music. It's funny how, like, I'll sit down, I'll grab the guitar, and the first thing I do, I'll record a voice memo.
Yeah.
I can go back years, and it's like, oh my God, I did the same thing. It's as if it's stuck in your head.
Sure.
And you just have to find a way to, like, extract it from the air, as any writer would do.
That's it, yeah.
It's like connecting dots in the air, like finding them, like, you know, we're basically astronomers.
Basically. Love it.
Yeah.
Yes.
Stare up at the sky. And then all of a sudden, you're like, oh, I love that. I love that. And that's how my mind works. And then it's just stringing those ideas together, really.
And you try and do that every morning if you can.
The morning's the easiest time to do it because, I mean, I'm burnt the hell out by like 8 o'clock at night.
See, I'm the opposite. I'm a
night owl.
I'm a midnight cowboy. Like,
oh man, I can do it sometimes. Like, but I need like someone there.
Yeah.
With me.
Although with me, with the little ones, it's become. It's a little different now because they're in school, so my days are back. So now now it's like finding.
Let's hope that they stay back.
Yes, let's hope. But it's definitely. It's much more difficult because it's. I don't want to say it's forced, but it's structured.
I think you have to structure your time. Like I mean,
work
for God's sakes. I mean, I go for a run in the morning.
Yeah.
And. I was talking to a friend today, and he's like, you do? I'm like, yeah, I try. I mean, sometimes I walk, sometimes I bike, sometimes I run. Depends on how my body's actually responding to, like, what I did to it.
Well, you have to bring it to life, you know?
You know, it's like, if I feel great, I'll like today I got up, and, you know, by 8:30 I was taking a walk, and I was smoking a spliff, and then, like, in the middle of that, I was like, 10 minutes later, I'm like, I'm gonna run. And then, boom, I just run. And like I like running after, you know, smoking a doobie because all of a sudden I don't remember that I'm running anymore.
Yeah.
I'm thinking about other stuff. I'm like, wow.
Do you find I get this way when I'm riding my bike because I cycle more than I run. I tried running.
I cycle too. If I can't run, I cycle.
I tried running for a long time, but I can't. I don't love it enough. I like working out and I like cycling. So I'll cycle for a
long. You like to move.
Yeah, but I like what I'd like. I used to do some mixed martial arts stuff too for a period of time because I like the tunnel vision focus. No, it's like how I like canoeing or swimming. It's like you are only focused on the one thing that you're doing and everything else is gone. It's like there's nothing in your
peripheral. Right, because otherwise you will die. It's like rock climbing.
Yeah.
Can't really be thinking about anything else.
That's how it, if I can bring that energy and that focus into a writing session, then everything's going to go well.
I agree with you.
You know?
Totally.
Because otherwise, often I try and sit and write and I'm thinking about, I just sit there and look over and I'm looking at
a book distracted
on the wall, or I look at a picture, or I do my best. Not, that's the thing about the phone too, right? You record I record voice memos often to keep track of things, but I try to keep my phone away because it's so easy just to check out something else. Anyways,
it's true. Can you imagine thinking about the relationship that didn't work while you're like 10 feet in the air climbing a rock? Yeah. You're not thinking about the relationship that didn't work. You're thinking about not falling off the rock.
Yeah.
It's that deadpan focus that I think music gives me.
Yeah.
When I'm playing and when I'm writing, I'm not thinking about anything else.
Where do you feel most alive in that space, in the studio or on the stage?
They're so different, and I surely enjoy the audience and the give back and the take. And that relationship and that communication and that community, I love it. I love the studio for its, perfection and imperfections. But I have to admit that my favorite thing is the inception.
Okay.
When I get an idea and I know it's a good idea, I get so jacked.
Yeah.
And I wish I had a studio and a live audience to witness that every time.
That moment.
Yeah. That moment, if I could have, that's like the lightning in the bottle moment. I know that Neil Young has like engineers, or did rather, where as soon as he had that moment, it was like, just hit record.
Yeah.
And we got that in a lot of the things that he's done, I'm sure. Not all the musicians in the world are as fortunate to have that sort of, those resources, but
sure.
That lightning in the bottle feeling, when you hit it, and you're like, when that lyric works,
yeah.
When that chord change works, and you
but
know.
But you find you take that energy with you every time you play that song.
It's interesting that you do.
Yeah.
But the first time, it's certainly like that shot of heroin.
Yeah. Especially songs, I find songs that are very, when you write songs that are really true stories,
Sure.
It's like that. I have to remember, I don't have to remember, I've honed in on that feeling of when I wrote it and those emotions, that energy, because that's...
It's like a photograph.
That's what's going to recreate. It's not the memory of what I'm telling, the story I'm telling. It's the moment that I felt that energy writing that part of that story, or the memory of, the feeling that I had in the moment of writing.
I hear that. I mean, You gotta think about how lucky we all really are, to have all of these things right here at the same time that we're alive, to hear music and to have our hearing, to see art and pictures with our eyes, to feel sculptures and to feel, I'm walking around my neighborhood and everybody's starting to get this AstroTurf. I'm like, why? The coolest thing about that is that my dog knows that they're dicks and always craps on their lawn. But just, the grass and your feet on the grass. It's just, there's so much in this world that it is energy based and it's so soulful, and it's so hard to fathom and so hard to explain. I mean, for God's sakes, they're trying to build machines that are like us, but there's nothing in the world like us. We are absolutely astonishing. Yeah. The fact that you can write a song, the fact that you can even cook breakfast, it's astonishing.
I want to talk about the ridge again.
Yeah, sure.
It's such a poignant and realized record, and it just paints this picture, and I'm taken into that world. But the song surprised me also. Like, it sort of takes you on a journey, and everything feels connected. Like you were talking about
the thread,
but it all has. Every song has its own energy, its own vibe. What was the inception of that record?
The inception of that record, I mean, some of the songs are actually older and were reworked in a different sort of mind frame. Like, for example, Ballad of a Young Troubadour that we played today.
Yeah.
That song is older than The Ridge. I was asked by a friend of mine, Roseanne, Barker Thornley, to be part of like this thing called the acoustic guitar project.
Yes.
And so I did it, and I had to write this song in a day, and I wrote the song in a day, and you know, submitted it, and that was done. And then I had this sort of little demo, and I was like, wow, this is a really telltaling story about my life. And I had the rough lyrics written out, and I went back and I rewrote the whole thing and went through it again. And that was the start of it. And then the next song would have been like an older song. I reworked It's Not Enough, and those are the two old songs from that particular record. And then everything else started pouring out. I mean, it's not the happiest of stories, but my family basically disintegrated on my mom's side within like a 5-year period of time. We lost everybody. My mom's the only living member of her family anymore, and there were 5 of them, and it just happened so quickly, really. And there was a lot of, you know, I mean, it goes back pretty far. There's a lot of turmoil and a lot of hurt and a lot of crazy politics and a lot of stuff that I didn't realize had happened in that particular story itself.
I see.
That I'd never even brought it into The Ridge. It was there. I wrote about it. I spoke about it. I went on walks with myself because I had to deal with other people's stuff, literally.
Yeah.
And I would go for hikes in the forest, and one day I decided just to record my conversations with myself, and they were like conversations with the people that A had left and the people that were here and you know, the relationships that just didn't work in the way that you thought they worked. And as a child, The Ridge really is about, what's so interesting about that particular song for me was that I wrote it, and the record was supposed to be called something else. I mean, I had funding for the record. I was recording the record, and then The Ridge song came out. My grandmother passed away, and The Ridge came out. And it was really like such a traumatic period of time in our lives. I mean, literally, my mom lost everyone.
Sure.
Like all of her sisters and her parents.
I'm so sorry, man.
We just were like...
Yeah.
So I wrote The Ridge, and it was really a song about innocence, but it's a painful song. You can feel it too. Like, it does have this storyline that takes you to this place, and you can see the place, and you can see the innocence and the happiness and the laughter. But then you hear that, like, there's also this hard sort of like knife that drags through it too.
Mm.
Like a ridge.
Yeah.
Which is interesting about that song for me, but it certainly was like if I could play the demo version, it's me sitting in my, like, on my bed, just like slowly. And the way that I strummed that song, it was the first time that I ever thought that, oh, I can do that. I don't have to like really go crazy. I don't play that song at all.
Mm-hmm.
In that, it's like all I do is, wow, this is like stuck here. All I did was this, and I was like, oh, it works.
Yeah.
I don't play it out.
You don't need to. You're telling the story.
And I was like, oh my God, neat. I don't have to actually try to play this. It just let it play itself.
Yeah, yeah.
It was really soft, and I kept it that way. So, because sometimes you write a song and you're like, it needs this, it needs that. And like, now I write songs, I'm like, it doesn't need anything. The song's fine.
That's kind of the dream, you know, where you're going to get to the point where the songs are, the words, the melody that you create is just going to tell the story itself.
Song's
you don't
fine.
Have to add anything to song, it. The song's could, fine
like,
as it is.
I've actually thought about like recording the new record and just doing the, just me and an acoustic guitar. And I could.
Yeah.
Be the same stuff. Doesn't have to. There's no flash. Don't need it. The song's fine.
Yeah. Well, and you're trusting your storytelling. You're trusting yourself.
I'm excited for the new record because I think it's the same, but different, as they say in Thailand. It's an interesting record, and I don't feel like I have to conform to any convention of what songwriting is, what music is. It's just, I just do me.
It seems to be working so far.
Whether it's working or not, it's fun, and it feels right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I appreciate it. I appreciate you. And
I appreciate you, too. And thank you. I'm sorry it took so long for us to get here.
Don't ever apologize. I knew it was going to happen. I knew it was going to work itself out, and here we are. So I want to say thank you so much for being on my show.
Thank you, brother.
And I look forward to your next record, my friend.
I look forward to yours. I always look forward to yourself. You yeah, have man. Such a beautiful voice.
Thank you. All right, much love. Songs on fire.